Hi all, and welcome to Occult Melbourne Part 3. First up, we'll just have a look at the floor of the Sports Girl store again. Just looking at that northeast region, all lit up there with the light coming out of it. Here we see a similarity on a what is perhaps a Masonic checkered floor with the obelisk here casting a shadow from the northeast corner during the rising of the sun on the summer solstice. Let's move on though into part three. Parliament House, Melbourne. The Parliament House is situated here. This is Spring Street here. So here we are in front of Parliament House, just panning around the Parliament of Victoria. We're looking now up onto the facade here, and we can see Mercury up there. Mercury, the messenger god, or Hermes, or Moses, if you will, or Tutmosis for that matter. Many names. So there he is with his caduceus. It's actually pointing towards where the pineal gland is, if you will. We'll just carry on further around the facade. We can see the pillars across the front there. Pillars are perhaps representative of people, pillars of society, if you will. Just a shot of the beautiful old trams that still run around Melbourne. Now up here on this facade we have a tortoise shell here. Now, coming from the guys from Gnostic Media, they're saying that the tortoise, and in fact the tortoise head that sort of extends out from the shell, is perhaps symbolic and phallic in nature. So, just carrying on from that, here we have the fasci with the axe handle coming out. And here we have an artist's palette that is perhaps representative of the seven liberal arts, if you will. We have the flame there, the torch, the flame, the light, perhaps representative of the pineal gland being lit up, or divine light, if you will. Little illustration here of the seven liberal arts, although there are perhaps more than that, but seven is that magic number. 7 days of the week, the seven observable orbs in the sky, so forth and so forth. So once again, we're out front here. We're out the front of Parliament buildings. So we'll just now zoom in. Up above here, up above the pillars, which are perhaps representative of people, we have this pine cone shape here, round pine cone. Interesting that it's got the square, the circle within a square, or the circle squared. So pineapple or pine cone type shape there, representing the pineal gland, no doubt, in part. Here we have geometry coming from a single point. On the mosaic floor in the forecourt of the Parliament of Victoria, we have these shapes here, which are we have the cross and these heart type areas are perhaps representative of the four seasons, perhaps, or these sort of geometries we get from the cosmos. So from the perspective of masons and so forth, you know, these things are symbolic and they're written into the buildings. Here we have the Templar cross running across the front of the porch or the forecourt of the Parliament of Victoria, with the round section in the middle. So this cross is perhaps representative of two crosses. Now you have a symbolic cross on the earth and a symbolic cross on the sun, and there is perhaps a larger cross as well for a galactic cross, if you will. And then we have symbology like the Union Jack, where we have the union of two crosses. Anyway, I'm not going to get too much into that. Within the middle of the cross here, we have this flower design once again, and we have a sort of an emanation of geometry coming from the flower, if you will. There's netting here, so it's not so easy to see that detail, keeping the pigeons out and so forth. So the Supreme Court of Melbourne also has this a similar configuration up in here, and it's hard to see. It's difficult to see the Templar cross, but it's up in here as well. So we have a similar motif on the Supreme Court in Melbourne. One of the things that got me into doing this work right from the start was the work of Brian Shaw, where he mentioned that one of the courts in Melbourne had a Masonic cornerstone somewhere. I wasn't able to locate it on this court, but he mentioned that, and it was one of the things that got me into doing this work right from the very start, so just giving him a mention there. So we're back at the Parliament of Victoria, and we can see with out of these twirls, out of these cosmic twirls, if you want, we have sort of the emanation of life coming from what are perhaps galactic twirls. So it's everything's so intricate, it's sort of written into everything. Up in here we have this crown and perhaps rulership over the earth, and we have the right on the top we have again that Templar cross. We have the sphere in the center here with these emanating cross parts or arms coming out of it, perhaps representing a conjunction of crosses, and this is perhaps sort of going beyond the earth, if we're going to accept this as the earth in this case. So let's just keep moving along. So we're just going to do a pan of Melbourne from the steps of the Parliament here. This building over here is the Princess Theatre. We'll have a look at that in a moment. And this is just a bit of a scan around. There really is some beautiful old buildings in Melbourne. And they still have the old trams running there. So this is the Princess Theatre on Spring Street. And up above here we have an angel in gold. This angel is perhaps an angle and perhaps representative of light emanating down from one of the, say, 360 angles from the heavens above, from the constellations of the zodiac, so to speak. We have the lion, Leo the lion here, perhaps representative also of the zodiac. But once again, you know, there are possibly other ways to interpret this, and I am just putting across what I feel may be the case. What I'm saying is not necessarily fact. Do your own research. Here we have the lion, we have the unicorn, Leo, the constellation of Leo perhaps, the Lion of Judah perhaps too, and here we have the unicorn representative of Capricorn. We'll keep moving along. Just having a look at the general architecture here. Now the Stanford Fountain. This fountain was created or designed by William Stanford. He was actually in and out of jail here in Australia for, we'll have a look on the plate, for something to do with horses actually. But the fountain here, the birds around the fountain are a reminder of the birds around the fountain in Sydney at Cockle Bay, at the Cockle Bay Wharf. The fountain, the design of the fountain looks very Masonic in structure. In design, I'm not sure if William Stanford was a Mason in any way or not. But anyway, it's an interesting fountain to quickly have a look at. And for those interested in the extra detail, I'm just going to point down here now and we will have a look at some of the detail and history behind this fountain. So there we go, William Stanford's in and out of jail. He was convicted of horse stealing and spent about 16 years in and out of jail, including 2 years hard labour and irons for escaping. And he actually designed, carved the young boy in jail, I think. Anyway, let's keep going. So we're looking at two murals of Prometheus here, where Prometheus is involved. So here he is up here on the horse. This wheel here is perhaps representative of the sun, being driven there by the horses. If we go down, we have an interesting depiction in the globe here with this geometry, reminding us of sort of atomic structure within the sphere here. Very interesting atom. That would be perhaps Zeus. And here we have Prometheus diving down back to Earth, bringing fire down to the grateful people on Earth, where it is utilized for all sorts of things that kind of make up our society. It's an important part of society and it's being used here. And there are two aspects to this mural. We have this one side where the fire is being utilized, and then this side here where the fire is in a destructive mode. We have Pandora here with Pandora's box, which was perhaps a jar. And what has perhaps come out of that box is something of an evil nature. If you read some, you know, depictions of what that story perhaps is. So it's a reminder of the female and how the female sort of sometimes gets depicted in these old stories. It's a reminder of Eve biting the apple, so to speak. Same sort of thing. So here is another building, the Monash House. And within that we have another mural of Prometheus coming down. I just think it's interesting, you know, just to show you that there is, you know, sort of high regard for these old stories and, you know, they're part of... part of the fabric of society, even though we perhaps in our day-to-day lives don't take much notice of it. Here we have a tree, the children's tree. This was designed by Tom Bass. On the top of the tree we have the owl, representing in this case perhaps knowledge. 1963 it was designed. And then at the bottom we have a lizard, and there's a small boy here focused on the lizard, the reptile. So we have the reptile at the bottom of the tree, perhaps representing sort of base knowledge, if you will, and then we have at the top of the tree that owl representing higher knowledge. Now, and there's the owl at the top. Now an aspect of this tree is that we have the boy and the girl, plus there is a little child there. So when I look at this, I also wonder if this is a representation of the Trinity. Here you have the girl, and there you have this little boy here. So you probably got if they were to be older, you would have the parents, the boy and the girl, the father and the mother and the child, making the Trinity as well. The tree of life. This perhaps totally represents a tree of life that is perhaps within us, and it's talking about consciousness and higher consciousness. So there you go. So as per usual, as far as I'm concerned, with virtually all of Tom Bass's stuff, there is an esoteric meaning behind what has been his sculptures that have been placed in numerous public places around Australia. Bye for now.